Welcome to the virtual lunch. Today is Thursday, April 8th, and this is virtual lunch number 278. I am honored today that Bob Rowe, the CEO of Integreon, is joining us as part of our fantastic April series on meaningful metrics.
I am a lawyer by training. Right around 2000, jumped over to what we now call new law or the alternative legal services market, got involved mostly on the e-discovery side. And then about 4 years ago, I joined Integreon as their CEO. It's probably for me been a renewed emphasis and deeper learning on what I would call the softer skills, probably something I should be emphasizing and relearning every day. But the pandemic really brought that to the forefront, things like empathy, active listening. It's one thing to be in a room and read body language. It's another to try to have a connection, particularly an emotional connection with one of your teammates when your normal habit is Zoom or Teams or a phone call. You've got to get better at those skill sets. Being global, in some ways, we were seeing things that maybe others who have more local or regional companies didn't get as much feedback on. So we're in the Philippines, we're in India, but in the Philippines in particular, they got hit first. We saw this and we started reading the paper and we're like, this could be coming. So the good news is we have to be 24/7, just the nature of our company. Since I've been here, Ari, we've dealt with earthquakes, volcanoes, mudslides, some crazy stuff. So the pandemic was probably an expanded or an extended crisis, but we had about 10 days to get out of our offices before the lockdowns hit. So we had to be pretty agile. We were able to get 98-99% of our workforce transitioned to a work from home in about 10 days. I'll speak for the alternative legal services market. Some people don't like the word alternative, but in particular, the notion of that suggests a mindset that most of the time, let's go to law firms, let's do it the tried and true way. Honestly, I think that the people in this industry have a mindset that this is truly a new way of doing business. And some of our clients, lawyers in general, we're a very conservative bunch. We go to law school and we're taught to ask, like, what can go wrong? If it's working really well, why try to change it? So when you get into our industry, trying to change mindsets can be a challenge, but that's what we're all about. So when you talk about resilience, we've been pushing the industry as a whole to adopt new ways of doing business, new workflows, new activities. So in some ways, it's that attitude that carries you. At the end of the day, it's a mindset. This industry as a whole carries that mindset. The pandemic's been tragic, don't get me wrong, but if there is at least a small upside that has come out of that, everybody's working from home. A year and a half ago, when we would go talk to some clients, they would say, you've got to be in that ISO certified facility. The cameras have to be there and you've got to put your phones in a locker. And all of a sudden, you didn't have even a choice. If you want this business done, you're going to be doing it from somebody's home, from their home internet. And here's what we can do for security. We all quickly learned there's a lot of great security that's come on the market in terms of biometrics and facial recognition and ways to securely do this work. What it has shown is if I can have this work done from anywhere, then that means I might not need to have it done by the traditional law firm. Nothing wrong there because that's obviously a need at times, but I can also have an alternative, somebody from new law. Even beyond that, I should be a little more open to where it's done. Doesn't have to be done in the United States. If you're working from the top of a mountain in Colorado, what's the difference between that and doing it from India or the Philippines? Because some people love this. Every couple of months, we send out a survey and there's a very healthy group of people saying, let's never go back. Yeah, there's also a percentage of people who say, please, I want to go back. I want to see my friends. I want to connect. Pretty broad spectrum. We're all going to have to be flexible to make it work. Fundamentally, I guess I would call it actionable metrics. Going back to our industry, a lot of people come to us for cost savings, the industry in general. At least that's what gets their curiosity piqued. But beyond cost savings, it's really about cost predictability. If you can, in this industry, tell people, here's what you're going to pay, and your invoice reflects that consistently, you're going to make some clients very happy. So the metrics that underlie the ability to predict that cost, predict the timing of your delivery, et cetera. Obviously, there's quality pieces too, but fundamentally, we rely upon that to guide all of our business decisions. If we're really not deriving actionable metrics from it in terms of predictability, it's going to be pretty tough to run that business unit. But a lot of people are like, how do I know what people are doing when they're at home? Frankly, as long as the work is being done and is being done on time and in the quality that we've promised, I'm less concerned because I know everyone is keeping a lot of plates spinning, whether it's homeschooling or running errands, et cetera. So what's important to me is the kinds of metrics that we are following. I'm less concerned about how much time someone's on a computer and is the work getting done right. Legal ops has contributed greatly to this. Legal operators may have a legal background, but what they really are bringing is a fresh set of eyes and a renewed perspective to say, how do we get this done? Honestly, between procurement and legal ops and our industry, we've really begun to challenge the notion of how do you measure things and how does that translate into a good business or work product delivery? In our business units, we say, what is the outcome our clients want? I go back to predictability as being a really big one. Obviously, some cost savings, quality. And so the metrics we derive all pour into those fairly obvious business goals. I will say my focus initially was, let me just understand 10 service offerings, some of these presentation graphics, contracts, legal word processing. I had exposure as, I guess, a recipient as a lawyer, but okay, how do you do this? So you have to go back and I think always be curious, be a student. Secondly, I focused a lot on culture because it's the team that really drove it. I build and hopefully protect culture, uphold standards. If I can do those two things and build the right values in this company, the other people will hopefully adopt those standards, those values, and the right results should come. The fact that we're kind of in this forced experiment, nobody would have done this a year ago. Who would have said, hey, let's all just work from home and give it a shot? Like, you're crazy. People aren't going to work that hard. As a matter of fact, it's not a lack of productivity. The problem is they don't know how to turn it off. I had to put a rule in place last year that you had to take PTO. You can carry over your PTO, but you have to take at least X number of days between now and the end of the year. This notion that when I call you, you better be in front of your computer for a Zoom call. That's kind of nuts. You do really have to trust the team. The other point I'd make is the old adage of activity does not equal productivity. I found how many times I was on a plane feeling I was so busy, being so productive. And frankly, I'm not quite sure what I was doing. Now I find I get time to think and to reflect. I don't want to go back to traveling every week. I think we've learned a lot of good best practices. There was actually a McKinsey study that was sent to me. It says that the ability to sell is actually enhanced in this environment because people will take 10 minutes to talk to you or 15 minutes on Zoom, and they never would have given you 15 minutes in their office before because of all the hassles. I'm encouraged that maybe there's some new opportunities. I know that every time I talk to somebody, they may be putting up a brave face. If you look at the statistics and what's happening, there's people who are struggling, but nobody wants to tell you about that. Nobody wants to be honest. It's hard to do, right? Particularly over Zoom saying, I'm really struggling here. Pre-COVID, you might say, hey, let's get together. Let's go for a walk. Let's have a cup of coffee. How do you do that in a virtual world? So it gets very challenging. Productivity is important, but how do you measure morale? How do you measure the emotional strength of your team virtually? But in military intelligence, there is what they call the intelligence loop. Some people call it the OODA loop, which is an acronym for observe, orient, decide, and act. Gather accurate information, analyze it quickly, act on it, then repeat the loop. Because the moment you act on something, you're going to change your environment. And then you got to gather new data and analyze it and then act. In the military, one of the principles is whoever can do that loop the quickest will typically be the winner. You're going to make mistakes. But here's the thing. If you make a mistake with the loop, that's the whole point of the loop. You can observe at the very beginning, this is not right. Let's change it. The battlefield will change. So you need to continue to read, react, and be agile. Okay. Metrics has to be in balance. I am very metrics driven, but if the team starts feeling like they are a metric themselves or just part of a metric, you've lost the battle. The first commitment we made as a company when this whole thing broke was we had a goal of not letting anybody go for a COVID-related reason, financial or otherwise. Now, there's a couple of companies who were like, you have to do the work in the office. It's just too sensitive. So we had teammates who were, what am I going to do? I'm going to lose my job. And we just told the team, you know, is there something that could be done over here, over there? To everyone's credit, nobody was let go for a COVID-related reason. Now, metrics, you could sit there and look at the board and say, well, how come your gross margin is going down? Because you've got a surplus of people who aren't being deployed. Those are important. They have to guide you. But at the end of the day, what are you going to remember coming out of COVID? That your gross margin was good in February or that the team took care of you when it was a tough time?
Hi, bro, everybody. And thanks, of course, to Integreon for supporting our month-long series on meaningful metrics.